you just use your formula. So what is covariance of xy? 36, yes, that's slightly tricky. Maybe after I do a problem today, that might be able to figure it out.
Which page, which problem is it?
That is page 375. 36, 38. So for covariance xy, so I mean for 38, you can simply use this formula. That's a form of covariance, right? So if it's continuous, plugging what you joined as is and integrate that of everything. So when you plug in your joint density, so the joint density is 2e to the negative 2x over x. Your x you can integrate all the way from 0 to infinity. Your y is from 0 to x. So then you need to figure out how to. What about exponential value of x? That's just. First, need to find the marginal density of x first.
Right.
Okay.
So
how do you do that? Use your formula for marginal density.
Right.
That is, you take your joint density, you integrate out your y. In this case, when you integrate out your y, when your x is fixed, you would just integrate from negative infinity to y. Basically, 0 to y, sorry. 0 to y and plug in that function. All right, so you would have to calculate that and then calculate the mean. And then expected value of y, you need to first find the joint density of, the margin density of y. So these are just, I've given you formulas. You need to first figure out whether you have all the information you need to use those formulas. You realize for this formula, you still need to find the margin density for x, so you first find that. Then you calculate the expected value of x, similarly with the expected value of y, plug into this formula. So that is, these are just calculus problems. Once you know the formula, it's just calculation. So these, just pick out any kind of problem that has compute the covariance and just calculate that. Now, that is what problem 38 would look like, but 36 is a little tricky. I think we do like some of the, I've also assigned some self-test problems, right? So if you look at them, I mean, the reason I assigned them is so that they help you with your homework assignment.
Mm-hmm.
So look at that, and there's another, here's an example I want to do. I mean, it's not going to be the same as 36. In fact, it's much simpler. But you kind of get an idea of how you should think of 36. Okay, so let's do this example. Let x equal number of sixes in n rows. And when I just say n rows of a die, I mean independent rows, in n rows of a fair die. When I say a fair die, it means each of the outcomes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 are equally likely. Find variance of x. So initially, this can look like a pretty complicated expression. Like if you think of variance of x as expected value of x squared minus expected value of x whole squared. X is number of sixes in n rows. So you count the number of sixes in n rows and calculate expected value of x squared of that. Well, okay, actually this is not difficult. I mean, number of sixes in n rows. You can think of it as what is it distributed as. By normal, right? Okay. So you are interested in calculating weight. Is that my question? Yeah, number 6 in mental, that's all I'm saying. Okay, yeah, so this is binomial variance effects are simple, but let me do it in a way that will kind of give you a hint for problem 36. Supposing you didn't recognize it as binomial. In a sense, the way we're doing it is, let's think of it this way. Let xi be like Bernoulli random variables. So xi is 1 or 0 depending on whether the ith row is a 6 or not. Okay? So it sounds like I'm making it more complicated, but remember, this is just an example of how you could do a problem like this and give you a hint for problem 36. So let xi equals 1 if ith row is a 6 and xi equals 0 if ith row is not a 6. Then I can think of x as, does this make sense? So for each row, if it results in a 6, I add 1. So if I do this for n rows, then I've added a 1 every time there was a 6 and a 0 every time there wasn't a 6. So if I add up your xi's, you're going to get the number of 6's, right? Okay. All right. Now, I want variance of x, so I want variance of summation I equals 1 to n xi. Supposing I didn't know anything about distributions and formulas for distributions, I could do something very simple like this. Okay. I've broken this problem down into the sum of very simple random variables. These are random variables with only two outcomes, 0 and 1. The probability that xi is 1 is 1/6. Probability is 0 is 5 over 6. All right, so it's easy for me to calculate the mean of xi. It's easy for me to calculate the variance of xi. Okay. All right. Now, here's where I'm going to use the properties of variance and covariance that I did last class. Okay. The variance for this is simply, if you remember the statement, is your variance of each of your xi's plus covariance of xi, xj. That's the general formula for variance of a sum. Now, I didn't say independent, but I mean in n independent rows. There's no way you can roll it so that they depend on each other. So they're n independent
rows. Thanks.
So if they're independent rows, then xi corresponds to the result of the ith row. Xj corresponds to the result of a jth row. So xi and xj cannot be dependent then, because I've said the rows are independent. So if xi and xj are independent, what do I know about covariance of xi xj? So this is something mentioned last class. What is the covariance?
It's 0.
It's 0, right? So these terms disappear, and in fact, so what I get is just this. Now, this was also, I think, a formula I just gave you last class. I told you that if the xi's are independent, then your variance of summation of xi's is just sum of the variance of xi's. And that was basically because we started off with this formula, but then we know the covariance terms are all 0. So now, variance of xi is very easy to calculate, even if you didn't know formulas for that. So variance of xi are basically expected value of xi squared minus expected value of xi. So let's calculate what is the expected value of xi. It's 1 sixth times 1 times 5 sixths times 0, right? So that's just 6. What's the expected value of xi squared? It's 1 sixth times 1 squared plus 5 sixths times 0 squared. So that's also 1 sixth. So variance of xi is? 1/6 minus 1/6 squared. 1/6 minus 1/6. 1/6. Therefore, variance of x is the summation I going from 1 to n of 5 out of 36. I add this number n times n. Check that we know another way of finding this because all of you recognize that x is just binomial with n and p equals 1/6. So this variance should be np 1 minus p, which is n 1/6 minus 6, n 5/6. So we have got the right answer. But even if you didn't know formulas for binomial distribution, you could always break down a problem like this into something very simple. You can write it as a sum of, you can think of it as indicator functions. Indicator functions are something which is one and a sudden event happens and zero otherwise. Okay? So if I can sum it as, so this is going to be a very useful trick. Keep this in mind and hopefully you know when to apply it. So in any situation where you feel you could split your random variable into some of these sort of indicator random variables, you can always use simple formulas like this. If the covariance is not zero, you'd have to calculate covariance of xi, xj. But in the case of independence, zero. So I want you to use this trick for problem 36.
Can we assume independence? I don't think it explicitly says anything.
For this one?
No, for 36.
So for 36, let x be, so what's wrong with the dimension here? The x and y?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Well, they can't be 1 and 2 at the same time. Is that what it, okay.
Right, yeah. So, 1 and 2 at the same time? Well, there's no reason to suspect that they're independent.
Right.
So, if you knew they were independent, the covariance xy would just be zero.
So
you'll
have to calculate.
Not. So you're going to have to calculate. X is the number of ones, y is the number of twos that occur in n rows of the Fed die. How can you write x? You can write x as a sum of xi's.
Mm-hmm.
Xi is defined like this.
Yep.
So you can write y as a sum of yi's, or yi is another thing. But of course, your xi and yj's need not be independent.
Okay,
let me put it this way. Xi and yj, so xi refers to the result for the ith row, yj refers to the result for the jth row. They should be independent, right? Because they refer to different rows. Xi and yi, of course, will be dependent.
Okay.
Right? But xi, yj, when I is not j, are independent. But xi, yi, so that's where you're going to have to do some extra calculations. Okay? So, so use a similar idea like this. Break down your x as a sum. Break down your y as a sum. And this is why these formulas for covariance are so useful. It makes calculations really simple. All right. Because otherwise, we look at problem 36 to calculate, first of all, the joint density of xy for n rows. It sounds a little complicated. I mean, it is going to be a complicated formula. But you can calculate covariance xy even without knowing the joint density of x and y, just because you can do something like this. All right. So you've got covariance of xi, so it's covariance of summation of xi, comma summation yi. I have given you formulas. You've got to apply your formulas. That if two random variables are independent, then of course covariance xy becomes independent. Because the expected value of xy just breaks into expected value of x times expected value of y, cancels with that, and zero. But I said that if covariance of xy was zero, it did not mean that x and y are independent. So let's do an example. I think we did an example on that, right? That if x and the covariance of x, y is zero, they need not be independent.
Yes, we did.
So we did one example of that.
Yep.
Here's another example. So when you think covariance or correlation, your initial thought is, okay, it's a measure of whether these are related or not. But actually, I told you it's not a measure of whether they're related or not, it's a measure of how linearly they're related. So let me give you another example. Let X be uniformly distributed, and Y be X squared. Find covariance of X squared. Look at covariance x, y. Six different value of x, y. So expected value of x, y, let's compute that. But what is y? Y is just x squared. So I get x cubed. X is uniformly distributed, so what's the density function of x? It's
1 over b minus a.
So it's uniformly distributed from negative 1 to plus 1. And so it's 1 over the length of the integral negative 1 to plus 1, which is 2. So that's the density function for x. So I want to expect a value of x cubed, so right, and the density function is when you calculate this, well, you're calculating an odd function from negative a to plus a, so 0. So expect a value of xy is 0. So you get this thing is 0 minus what is the mean of uniform distributed random variable from negative 1 to plus 1? Negative 1 plus 1 divided by 2, so that's a 0. And this 0 times the expected value of y. You don't need to calculate what the expected value of y is. You know that this is 0. So covariance is 0, but these are clearly related, right? So you would think that is kind of strange. They are related, they are dependent. And covariance is zero. Exactly. They're not linearly related. And if you think of this graph, there's no line that can even come close to describing the relationship. Okay? If maybe if you had x cubed, okay, that could be this some kind of maybe this line could sort of approximate it, right? So here, any line, if it had positive slope, it's too far away from these terms. If it has negative slope, it's too far away from these terms. So it's x cubed. So maybe try with y equals x cubed. Chances are covariance won't be 0. It may not be plus or minus 1, but it would be something more than 0. All right, so y and x are really needed. If you want to think of the joint density of them, this could be a good exercise. What do you think the joint density of these two would be? How would you write it? Well, something you should be able to say right away. If y is not x squared, joint density should be 0. Right? I'm talking about the joint density of x and y, where y is given by capital X squared. So y is a random variable capital X squared. And what would you think this would be? It would just be, so this is just the density corresponding, you can use our formulas. It's f of, general formula. If it was independent, this would just be the density for y. But if they're not, you have to put this. The density of x is just 1/2. So of course, assuming this. And when x, you can think of it this way: when x takes a value little x, your y takes a value. This should be okay. Think in terms of probability. This is not quite right to think of it this way, but you'll have to think of it as some constant. And what constant should I put it as? Well, you can put it as a constant, which when you integrate out. So this would be a good description, So you can, think of x and y having joint density like this. It's 1/2 when x is between -1 and 1 and y is x squared and 0 otherwise. So they're clearly dependent because this is non-zero when there's some relation between x and y. Alright, so you have a couple of examples where you see that you have dependent x and y's, but covariance is zero. So only if independent you get the covariance to be zero, dependent they could be zero or not. So zero covariance does not imply independence.
What you're about to erase, one of those integrals was from negative infinity to y, right? Or was it from, which one was
all
the one?
All of them, the way I've written it, is all from negative infinity to plus infinity.
Oh, what was the one that will end up being, I thought you said one of them was, no.
Well, I mean, that you apply your formula, look at your problem and see what your density function is.
Yeah.
So that, it depends on the problem, I forgot.
Okay.
but the way I've written it, if I just write it as, you should put in the density function there, all your integrals go from negative infinity to plus infinity.
Okay.
When you actually plug in your density function, over some region the density function is zero, so that would change your limits of integration.
Right.